Welcome to part 3. In this video, let's look at how to send the temperature sensor data of our smart fridge to a server. First things first, we need to connect the mini fridge to the internet. So let me do that by connecting it to the Wi-Fi I have at home. I'm using MicroPython on my ESP8266. The mini fridge is going to act as a Wi-Fi client, meaning a Wi-Fi station. And my Wi-Fi router is going to be the access point for the fridge. So let me first configure this as a Wi-Fi client. Next, let me switch on the Wi-Fi radio and configure the SSID and password of my Wi-Fi router. After this, I'm going to test whether the device is able to connect to the Wi-Fi router. And if the connection is successful, then I will also print out the network configuration to check if everything is good. Okay, it's connected successfully. Now that we have an internet-enabled fridge with us, I will have to figure out how to transmit the internal temperature to a remote server so that I can monitor or process this information from anywhere at any time. We have plenty of lightweight protocols today for transferring data between devices and server, but one of the most popular is the MQTT protocol, which we will be using for our device. I will have a more detailed video on MQTT later, but for now, let me give you a high-level explanation for your understanding. Most of the IoT devices have low processing speed, less memory, and network connectivity with limited bandwidth. So it's a major challenge to transmit and receive the data from a very resource-constrained device. We need a lightweight protocol to serve such a need. And MQTT is a perfect fit because it is minimalistic and robust at the same time. So we have a remote server to receive the data, and it is the responsibility of the ESP8266 in our mini fridge to collect the data from the sensor to transmit it to the server. The client first establishes a connection with the server. Then once successful, it publishes the data to the server in a particular topic at configured intervals. For example, the client may be programmed to transmit the temperature under a topic temperature. Now, if I have to view this data either from my mobile or laptop, I will have to connect to the server as another MQTT client. First, I will establish another connection from this client to the server. Then I will subscribe to the topic, let's say temperature. Now, once I have subscribed to this topic, every time the mini fridge publishes the temperature to the server, a copy of it will be delivered to my phone as well. The data that we receive on the phone will appear as raw data, meaning it is not formatted, and we will have to process the data to present it better, either graphically or in some tabulated form. Now, if I have another device, say a laptop, I can always connect to the server and subscribe to the same topic so that I receive the temperature details on both the phone and the laptop. To demonstrate the working, I have purchased a virtual private server on Amazon Cloud for our channel. I will be using this virtual server to host a MQTT server. So let's get started. There are plenty of open source MQTT servers in the market. I'm going to use one such server called Mosquito. Alright, I got the server configured and up and running. It is also available on a public IP, listening on port 1883. Now let me use a MQTT client to connect to the server and check whether it is working. I'm going to publish some test data on a topic called temperature and subscribe to the same topic from another client. Now that I have both the clients connected to the server, when I publish data from one client, I should be able to see it in the other client. Okay, the communication is good. Next, I have to get an MQTT client running in the ESP8266 in order to connect to our MQTT server. So I'm going to use the MicroPython's UMQTT client here. A few things that has to be kept ready are a unique client ID, server's IP address and port, optionally a username and password if you would like to keep unauthorized users out of the system, and most importantly, the topic in which the data will be published. Now all this information has to be fed into the MQTT client constructor, and using the MQTT client object, we can connect to the MQTT server. I will also include the temperature details as part of the temperature topic through the same object. Okay, now the server is able to receive the data. I can also cross-verify this by subscribing to this topic from my MQTT client on my laptop. But the data that I receive is in raw format, meaning I only see a series of running numbers like 29, 28, 27, etc. Now, this raw data is not very useful to me unless I process it to get some information out of it. We already have the MQTT server running in our Amazon cloud. So I'm going to use the same machine to run another server called Grafana, which I can use for visualizing the raw data. Grafana can consolidate data from various sources and present it beautifully on screen as graphs. Using Grafana, you can create different types of dashboards with customized graphs and even do real-time analytics on it. This is primarily an open source software that helps any IoT-based project to visualize any time series data. Now, in order to have our data on the dashboard of Grafana, we need to point it to a data source. We cannot just connect Grafana to our MQTT server, so we are going to use a database which will act as an intermediary between the data source and Grafana. I assume you already have some basic idea about databases. It's very important to choose the right database here. In IoT, we expect to have hundreds of devices deployed on the field, and each of these devices may transmit data sporadically. This data has to be stored as a time series data in a database. Now, it's very important to choose a database that specifically serves this purpose. Take for example, if you choose an SQL, which is the relational database, its purpose and way of working is completely unique. You'll have to create the tables, schemas, etc. well in advance before you start storing data in them. If you use a relational database to store millions of data points, and let's say you want to retrieve the last 2 years' data, the database will choke. On the other hand, if you use a database specifically designed to handle the time series data, then the database automatically optimizes the way the data is stored to make it much easier and faster to retrieve the data in the future. Today, we got plenty of open source databases available for this purpose, like Cassandra, InfluxDB, Graphite, etc. And InfluxDB happens to be the most popular in all of them. InfluxDB is so much faster than relational databases, especially for time series data from IoT devices. Besides that, InfluxDB is also very good for performing real-time analysis of data. There is another reason for choosing InfluxDB. It has these features called continuous querying and retention policies which enable compressing of whole data and efficiently retrieving them. There are plenty of ways to connect to the InfluxDB. We are going to use Python client to connect to the DB. Since both the MQTT client and InfluxDB uses Python, we are going to write a small Python script to receive the data from the MQTT server and deliver it to the InfluxDB. Then we can have the Grafana server connect to the InfluxDB to fetch the data as it comes in and then use the data to create beautiful graphs to display to the users. Now let's quickly write some test code to try it out. I'm going to use Paho MQTT client to receive the data from the MQTT server and then store it in the InfluxDB. Let me first connect to the database and then to the MQTT server, so that if the client receives any data, it can deliver it to the database. Okay, first I have to get the database ready. So let me create a database by the name IoT Fridge. We don't have to create a schema here. The database itself will take care of it based on the data that it receives. Let me then start Python script that will deliver the data to the database. Okay, the connection looks good. So if it receives any data, it will start delivering it to the DB. Now let's move on to the Grafana server. I have mapped the public IP address to the subdomain called iot.ting.co.in and the server is running on port number 3000. That's the login screen. First, we have to link the database that we created to Grafana. So I'm providing the server connection details here. Once done, we can test the connectivity with the database server. Okay, that looks good too. Next, I'm going to create a dashboard with the graph for visualizing the data that I'm receiving from the sensor. First, I have to choose the type of graph I want and select the fields that I have to query from the database. Aha! There we have the graph. This is an interactive graph, so let me check out the data that I have got in the past 3 hours. We can assign labels to the X and Y axis here. Since this is temperature data, I am changing the Y axis to Celsius and defining the maximum and minimum positions of the temperature. And since this is a time series graph, I am changing the X axis to time. Besides graphs, various other panels can also be added here. Let me add another panel called Single Stats to display the last received temperature. We can even configure the single styles panel as a gauge and even resize the panels to our liking. I will talk more about how to do analytics in my upcoming videos. Right now, I'm accessing the pages from my computer, but we can even access it from our phone. The pages of Grafana are compatible with both computers and phones. If you are planning to do a similar project and are finding it hard to configure a server by yourself, you can even try a third-party server. For example, Adafruit IO is a third-party MQTT server that is easy and user-friendly to use. You can push all your sensor data to this server and visualize it through their interface. Okay, we have come to the end of the video. For the first time, I had to split the video into three parts due to the complexity of the project. Let me know in the comments below whether this is good or if you have any suggestions to improve it. Looking forward to your feedback. Until next time, this is Satyan and I thank you for watching this video.